Good afternoon, friends, colleagues, comrades, esteemed members of the panel. My message for you in this speech is a fairly simple one. That this country, Britain, is being sucked into a military confrontation with Iran. Over the coming months, weeks, years, possibly, this country is likely to find itself in a position of military confrontation with Iran. Nothing is inevitable at this stage. At this moment, I don't think there is a clear plan in place for that military conflict to occur. But unless something is done about it, I think we will find ourselves in a position whereby confrontation with Iran becomes unstoppable over the coming months. This is seen most overtly in the way in which the US at the moment is blaming Iran for almost everything that goes wrong in the world today. From the conflict in Yemen, the world's worst humanitarian disaster, caused by the Saudi bombing, is blamed by the US on the Iranian attempt to spread its influence across the region. The unceasing conflict in Palestine and the Palestinian non-participation in the Jared Kushner plan to give a few vague plans of economic promise to the Palestinians in return for the large-scale confiscation of their land, is blamed on Iran's malign influence among the Palestinians. The conflict across the Lebanese border, with Israel hitting targets within South Lebanon and Beirut, is blamed on provocation from Iran's client Hezbollah in Lebanon. In Syria, the retention of power by the mass murderous regime in Damascus is blamed upon the Iranians propping up government. All of those may have some kernel of truth, but the exaggeration of those claims and the attributing of them solely to Iran shows the direction of travel of the US administration. Similarly, the abhorrent practices of the Iranian government within its own territory, the detention of dual nationals off the most spurious charges, its highly discriminatory policies towards elements of its own population, are themselves things that should appall us at times. But they're also far from uncommon among in the region itself, including among US allies in the region. And it pales in comparison to what a military conflict or the deepening of sanctions would bring in Iran for the vast majority of the people. The main tool, however, hasn't just been blame, but it's been the sanctions regime that has been in place since the US pulled out of the JCPOA, which Abbas mentioned. Now, my point here is not just that sanctions are causing terrible suffering for ordinary Iranians, but it's that sanctions themselves are a way to provoke Iran. Now, we often think about sanctions as an alternative to them. Rather than bombing, they starve the people. It's a tactic of pressure. But in this case, I think something different is going on. There is an attempt at slow strangulation of the Iranian economy, not for the purposes of containment, but to goad Iran into lashing out. It's to provoke Iranian actions taken by the Iranian military, especially the IRGC, to take action that would then justify escalating US military attacks upon Iran. You see it in the ways in which sanctions have been brought out at particular moments when tensions have been high. It's been brought out at those moments to try to provoke Iranian military responses, including in the Persian Gulf region itself. It's brought out in the very provocative attempts to bribe ship captains, to not just the captain of what is now the Al-Tarandaya, but across Iranian assets, for people essentially to pilfer the resources and to hand them over to the US as a way again to cause the Iranians to lash out. It reminds me of what was done in Iraq, 2002 to 2003. The older heads, and I see a few of you in the audience, will remember how the inspections regime in Iraq was used deliberately by the US as a way to get the Iraqi government at the time to cause a breach of the inspections regime, which would then justify the invasion. It was being publicly revealed afterwards in the documents that we see from the Blair government that was a deliberate way in which the British government was backing the inspections in the belief that they would be stopped by the Iraqi government, justifying military intervention. And you see a similar thing going on with regard to the US tactic of sanctions upon Iran. Now, the Iranian regime, despite its cynical nature, is not stupid, but they're also very resistant to anything that looks like humiliation on the international stage. You see it in the way in which the rhetoric from the Iranian government internationally remains a confrontation. And over the decades, the Iranian government has learnt that its interests are only taken seriously on the international stage when it challenges the interests of outside powers. Now, what I want to emphasise is that this isn't a definite plan. John Bolton and Mike Pompeo, the Secretary of State, may have their own plans, but they don't control US foreign policy in the way that, say, Dick Cheney under George Bush Jr. administration did. I'm reminded, though, of a set of documents that I leaked in 2004, a set of documents that came from Downing Street. It became known in the US as the Downing Street Memo, which was from mid-2002, the most well-known of which reported the head of MI6, Richard Dearlo, telling the Prime Minister that the US government was, the intelligence and the facts was being steered around the policy being one of regime change. In that context, in those documents I revealed, the American and British governments were deliberately twisting the intelligence they had, deliberately designing claims, claiming certainty about those assertions, claiming they were facts when they were suspicions, claiming they were policies when they were one-off incidents. And you see something similar going on with Iran at the moment. You see a very straight parallel with where we were in mid-2002 with Iran today. Whereby claims have been made about Iran's actions, a policy is being built up, a set of allegations are being systematically made about Iran, which don't make sense unless there is an overall object of regime change in that country. And here at least, it's not just the US, but also its key regional ally, which is Saudi Arabia. Israel, we mentioned earlier, but here at least Saudi Arabia is far more important than the US ally. A Saudi government under the erratic influence of Mohammed bin Salman, who's a de facto ruler of Saudi Arabia, who openly compares the Iranian leadership to Hitler and calling for it to be overthrown. That sort of impetuous leadership converges with the impetuous leadership of the US in a way that makes a particularly dangerous pattern emerging. Now, what would be able to restrain this, I think, still, is an attempt by the European Union states to form an international consensus around the potential for the JCPOA to be continued, for the parties to that, aside from the US, to uphold their commitments under that agreement. Instead, what we've seen is a consistently slow process of response. The US withdrew in May 2018. It took over a year for the European Union free to install the system called Instex, for bartering for humanitarian goods with Iran, essentially treating Iran as a charity case for whom medicines can be supplied in return for goods. It took over a year to create that. It doesn't incorporate non-EU states and it has a minimal effect upon the situation as it stands. It was clear from the start of Trump's administration that it was glad with the JCPOA, but the slow response of the EU shows the lack of sense of commitment actually stopping a war in the region. And the way in which the US has achieved that has not been through France or Germany, but it's been through Britain. And that's where the UK role becomes particularly important. It's most clear in the way in which the US administration turns to the UK to be the stalling force within the EU3 to stop any sort of compromise with Iran from emerging. any sort of response to the JCPOA, that state that keeps them within the terms of the bargain. And of course, it's most clear, something that Bas mentioned earlier, which is the US-led military armada in the Gulf today. Britain joined it in August, the start of August. It did it overtly in the name of protecting shipping through the Gulf. But of course, the US plan is not just to protect its shipping through the Gulf region. It's also to stop Iran selling its oil on the international markets. And so part of the US military Navy's role in the Gulf is to harass Iranian ships. It's to stop them leaving Iranian ports unimpeded. It's to stop them moving out through the straits onto Salam Islands elsewhere. Now, Britain at least says it's not part of that, but as tensions rise, as they will continue to rise in the region, the US has essentially committed its, the UK has committed its Navy to helping the US efforts. And this is where we see the actual potential for confrontation between the UK and Iran emerging, according not to a British plan, but according to an American plan. And of course, it comes out in the context of Brexit. When Mike Pence was here in London last week, of course, Iran was on the agenda in his talks with Boris Johnson. We often talk about Britain, with British government as having a no-deal policy. There is a deal with us, and that's a deal not with the European Union, but a deal with the US. And for that deal, as the British government sees it, there will be foreign policy costs. There'll be a tag attached to that foreign policy. And going along with US policy in the Gulf, I think, is clearly going to be part of that price we pay if we sign up to the deal with the US. And with that, I think, is the point at which we need to insist, because that's where it becomes increasingly difficult stop anything happening that will stop this march